Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this lovely occasion that we get to celebrate tonight. My name is Shellie Schwanke, and it is my privilege to serve my alma mater as the Director of Alumni Relations and the Director of the Ronald W. Reagan Society. Why, thank you very much. On behalf of President Wright and the trustees of Eureka College, I welcome you on this special day that commemorates the college's founding and our special alumnus whose birthday is celebrated today. I am now pleased to call Kate Summers, our Senior Disciples of Christ Fellow, forward to give the blessing for our evening. Kate?
Will you please pray with me? God of grace and wisdom, we are thankful for all you have done here at Eureka and all that you will continue to do. Please be within these conversations tonight so they may be fruitful for the furthering of this institution. For the food we are about to eat, we give you thanks. May it strengthen our bodies and our souls. In the name of the one who comes before us, will be here after us and sustain us always, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Kate. That was a lovely prayer. So, we prayed early, so I encourage you to start enjoying your salads right now. We are going to move this evening along, so please enjoy the feast before you. So the other night, I was pondering my comments, and as I prepared for this evening, and I thought, how do I put in words how significant February 6th is to the alumni of Eureka College? Well, as some of you know, my eldest daughter, Lauren, was born on February 6th. So as a mother, nothing can compare to that. But before I became a mother, I was a student here, neath the elms. And one of my favorite memories was the 1986 gala event that launched the Reagan Scholar Fellowship Program. It was held at the Willard Hotel in Washington, D.C. And some of you in the audience here were there. In fact, Rodney Gould, I know for a fact, was there because he was my classmate. Well, I have uncovered a real gem from that evening, and it captures the significance of this date and this birthday dinner, and it's in the words of our birthday boy himself. Please take a look.
And I thank all of you. The kind of generosity that you're showing this evening is the kind that built not just Eureka College, but America itself. And could I just take a minute, because maybe some of you who are being so kind don't know very much about that little school out there on the prairie. Well, in the first place, it is the oldest coeducational college west of the Alleghenies. And it was started from some people who arrived there in that part of Illinois in a wagon train from the east. And a man named Ben Major, whose family still lives there in the college town, his descendants, decided that this is where they would stay. He was the leader. He sank an axe in a stump, and he said, here is where we will build our school. And they built their school before they built their homes. And it became Walnut Grove Academy. And then, when it graduated above that, it became Eureka College. But this little school, so rich with tradition, and has contributed so much, and people like myself who went there, you were never too poor. But what if they could make it possible for you to get that education. There used to be a giant elm, which finally has given up, outside of one of the buildings, called Burgess. It was called Recruiting Elm, outside of Burgess Hall, because Captain Burgess in the Civil War stood down beneath that tree and called up to the classrooms of the one building at that time of the college for them young men to come down and enlist in the Union Army. Now, it isn't true that I was one of the young men then. But as I say, tradition that is so rich, and as you've been told, the wonderful thing about a small liberal arts college of that kind is not only that you get a good education, but you can't hide. You can't just go to class and back to your quarters again as you could in some of the great universities. I've been a regent of the 9-campus University of California by way of being governor. I was a member of the board of the 23-college state college system of California. As a sports announcer, I saw the inside of a great many of the great universities. If I had it to do over again, I would go to Eureka College. It means that much, and I think it meant that much to me. You can't hide. Everybody's needed, whether it's for Glee Club or student officers or athletics or whatever it may be. They grab you and they bring you in, and you find out talents and abilities that you never knew you had. So I just want you to know how deeply grateful I am, and that what you have done and what you are doing for this institution is for something that is very worthwhile. And maybe there aren't as many of them left in the country as there should be, but I pray to God there will always be a Eureka College there in the heart of Illinois. Thank you all very much. God bless you all.
Wasn't that a wonderful video? Speaking about Founders Day, he knows our history better than I do, I think. But that just warmed my heart to see that, and I really wanted to share that with you this evening. And his thank you to the people in that room. They were the first of many donors to the Ronald W. Reagan Society and the Fellowship Program. So I felt as though he's speaking to many of you this evening who are here. So we really appreciate that. So I think that was so wonderful, it deserves a toast or two, don't you think? So I'm inviting Marisa and Cody to the stage to do the honors. Thank you.
Now let's raise our glass to Eureka College, our second home beneath the elms. For many of us, Eureka has provided opportunities, friends, and memories that we would not have otherwise had. Through all the ups and downs, joys and sorrows, excitements and pains, Eureka College has made us more stronger, wiser, and whole people. Here's to Eureka.
First and foremost, I'd like to say a massive thank you to Teresa Kennel and Shellie Schwanke for coordinating this incredible event. On this campus, the legacy of Ronald W. Reagan is highly regarded. From his accomplishments as a leader on the football field and as a student advocate, there is a good reason we continue to recognize him almost 9 decades after his graduation. To be the only seated president to establish a scholarship at his alma mater in his name, without whom we would not have celebrated the 30th anniversary commemorating the fall of the Berlin Wall this past November. His capacity to lead exceeded most. Here's to the legacy of the great communicator, Ronald W. Reagan.
Marisa and Cody are senior Reagan fellows, and they make me very proud. So thank you very much for offering those toasts for us this evening. So, Eureka truly is a special place. Please continue eating and enjoy yourself. I'm just going to share with you that Eureka is a very special place. It has been for 165 years. And many of us know it wouldn't be here without all of you this evening. So I thank you all for your commitment to our alma mater. And I encourage you to continue to support our mission through your time, talent, and treasure. Now, Dr. Wright, I hope you've enjoyed your salad. That's right. So I would like to welcome Dr. Jamel Wright, the 27th president of Eureka College, to give greetings on this special occasion. Dr. Wright, you are an amazing leader of our community and our college, and I look forward to hearing your comments.
Thank you so much. Well, good evening to you all. You all right? Okay. No workman's comp here. You'll be falling down steps and stuff, Shellie. That didn't work out. And before I get started for table three, Mark and Bill in particular, you all are responsible for protecting my dessert from my husband. Because he's already eaten his, and I do not want him to use this opportunity to somehow have mine make its way around the table in front of him. So yes, good evening to you all once again. That video was fantastic. Wasn't it absolutely amazing? Shellie, the finalist, that was really, really wonderful. So 109th birthday celebration. That's really something. Of our most famous alumnus, President Ronald Wilson Reagan. So I just wanna thank you all for coming this evening. I wanna welcome especially our keynote speaker, Mark Weinberg. I have read his book. Now he claims that I must be the only one. He actually said that. That's not a joke that I wrote. He said it. That was what he said. I'm convinced that at least, Mark, there are two of us, because I think Shellie read at least half of it. One and a half. But having chatted with Mark, as you can see, he has a great sense of humor. And having read his book, I can tell you all that we are definitely in for quite a treat. And we are so very fortunate to have nationally renowned speakers who come to us, who were confidants, who were staff advisors of President Reagan, who come to our little Eureka College. And we are convinced, Mark, I tell you, that the only way you can really fully put the picture together and understand Ronald Reagan is by visiting our campus. So we definitely welcome you. We are very proud of our Reagan story. It is one that we hold near and dear, and that we often say that no one can tell that story better than us. And we completely understand why he says that everything good in his life began here. It is definitely a claim that others understand once they visit our campus. And we know that you too have some unique stories that maybe only you can tell. And we look forward to hearing those remarks from you later this evening. Firsthand knowledge is always great. I also want to offer a special acknowledgement to some of our community partners who have so graciously joined us this evening. We appreciate your continued support. We thank you all for making the drive, for taking our time to celebrate this occasion with us. We find it a noteworthy occasion, and it's always great to have our supporters in the room. We cannot do what we do without you all's support. So please continue to support our efforts. You know, there was, as I was researching in preparation to come to Eureka, which is going on a complete 6 years ago, I was amazed, and I actually didn't believe it, John Morris, when I first read and saw that the founding of Eureka College was the exact same date as Reagan's birthday. I thought, what are the chances of that actually being true? Is it true? Is that just something that the marketing folks put up? Brittany wasn't here then. I'm sure that's not true, right, Brittany? As I thought about it more, though, and as I've now been at Eureka College for almost 6 full years, now I think, how fitting that these noteworthy celebratory occasions would collide in such perfect alignment. While not a founding member of Eureka College, Reagan is the true embodiment of the values that we espouse. He is the epitome and standard bearer of excellence in learning, service, and leadership. And he had to be, I'm convinced, he had to be the type of student that our founders had in mind when they chartered this institution in 1855, 165 years ago today. He, like many of our students since and before, came to EC not expecting all they received. While the Christian Church Disciples of Christ roots were important to Dutch, more compelling, as the story goes, was his girlfriend who came to EC, right, Mike? She came as a young man. He didn't have the foresight to know then that this place would change the course of his life. He didn't know about the focus on inclusivity, that he would stand before his peers to rally their support as a second semester freshman, that there would be a coach who cared so deeply for him that he would receive a scholarship in order to stay and continue his education. He didn't know about the personal touch. He didn't know that he would get to double major or play two sports. It was this college, founded by abolitionists who were courageous enough to charter an institution that allowed women and men to be admitted equally, who even in 1855 believed that higher education should provide personal edification and growth and an appreciation for lifelong learning. That's the college that Ronald Reagan attended, and he had no idea of all that he would achieve as a result. Reagan chose us, and we cultivated and cared for him in ways unimaginable. Mark, believe it or not, in 1855, 1932, when Reagan graduated, and now in 2020, we continue to provide the Dutch Reagan experience for young men and women who don't either have the foresight to know the unbelievable transformation they will undergo, the unconditional support they will receive, the extraordinary experiences, many of which will push them well beyond their boundaries of comfort. And as a result, they, like Reagan, don't know the amazing heights they will reach. This day, February 6th, is significant to us all, for not only was our most famous alumnus born on this day, but so too was this extraordinary institution that nurtured and affirmed him to become the leader that he was. We should feel exceedingly proud of this 165-year-old institution that produced the likes of Ronald Reagan. His success puts us in an elite category. As you all know, we're one of only 23 to ever graduate a future president of the United States, and we are by far the smallest. That is significant. Celebrations such as this offer a unique opportunity for us to come together and be reminded of the endless points of pride we should carry with us and freely share, as you heard Reagan do in the video. He didn't keep this extraordinary place a secret, and neither should we. We celebrate Reagan's birthday because it is a chance for us to honor the legacy he left us, and we celebrate Founders Day to honor the legacy we shared with him. As we celebrate these two historically significant occasions, we thank you too for embodying the kind of giving spirit that Reagan had, and for embracing the founding principles of this institution like Dutch did. We ask that you all remain committed to this elite institution, as he said, on the prairie and neath the elms, which you have every reason to be proud. We need your support and we value it, and we want to know who the next Dutch Reagan will be, and look forward to your support in transforming the Dutch Reagans of today. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. Please enjoy your dinner. I know it will be amazing. I don't know if Shellie, you're gonna talk about the spirit behind what we will be having for dinner, but I wanna tell you all that, so you can give Shellie another hand as she comes back. She's really doing an amazing job and doing some exceedingly creative things in her role as the director of the Reagan Society, and she continues to surprise me and make me proud every time she comes with a creative idea. So as you come back to join us, we'd like to celebrate you as well, and thank you. Mike, that's the first time that I didn't throw shots out at you because you told me it would hurt your feelings tonight, so I lived up to what I said. Thank you so much, Dr. Wright. Well, I'm not going to talk all evening long. I just really want you to be aware that tonight we are enjoying Sodexo's version of Reagan's favorite White House chicken, according
to recipes.com. So Mark, our guest after dinner, he may take issue with this, but I know Sodexo has done a wonderful job working hard to prepare this for us. So please, I encourage you to, I'm not stepping up here again for another few minutes, so please enjoy the fellowship and the chicken. Thank you. My compliments to Sodexo for doing such a nice job. So please, yes, please. So please continue to enjoy your dessert, and I believe coffee will be served here soon. But I wanted to take another moment to share with you a little story, a little event that took place today at lunch. Our special guest and I arrived at about 11:30 and joined some Reagan fellows for a little bit of lunch. And while we were there, excuse me, we discovered that the students were very excited about a particular video of President Reagan that was created in 1989. And it's shown very regularly. And unlike the first one, where I want you all to know that you're the first to see that in 30 years. So I'm glad you came to me. So the students were so excited about this this little video that they pulled it up on their phones and they showed it to our speaker. And so I would like for you to just enjoy, it's about a 4-minute video, so please continue to eat and enjoy this video, please.
Hello, this is Ronald Reagan. Anyone who knows me is aware of the fact that I believe strongly in building leadership in our young people. It's important because this country has a tremendous need for vibrant young men and women of vision and determination. We need leaders with honesty, integrity, and a strong sense of personal values. And I've always felt Eureka is one place to find such individuals. I attended Eureka many, many years ago, long before any of you were born. But the experiences I had back in the 1930s are much the same as those you will have today if you choose to attend this wonderful institution that represents the finest in education. Back when I was a student, we learned about pride in country. We learned about the value of hard work and faith in the individual. We learned that anything in life is possible. And of course, we learned how to have fun. Today, you are faced with similar challenges. Young people such as you have a unique opportunity, and yes, a responsibility, to see to it that this country stays on the right track and continues to be a beacon of hope to people around the world. And for those of us who have been around this great nation an awfully long time, I hope you know that we're counting on you. I'm delighted that today you are learning more about the opportunities available at Eureka and also about the Reagan Scholarship Program. To give you a bit of history, back in 1982, I was approached about the idea of establishing a scholarship in my name. I was deeply touched and honored by the thought, especially since Eureka was and still is such an important part of my life. For the past decade, Reagan Scholars have been a diverse group with a variety of talents and interests, experiences, backgrounds, and ideas about our country. It's exciting for me personally to meet many of these bright individuals knowing that they will be guiding our country in the years to come. They are leaders. They are doers. They care about this country and are determined to do their part. I hope you will join them by choosing to become one of them. Wherever you decide to attend school, I wish you the best of luck. Your college years will be some of the sweetest years of your life, unlike anything you have ever experienced. You will find that in 4 short years, you will blink and college is gone. You go to class, pull an occasional all-nighter, struggle through chemistry classes. You fall in and out of love. You cheer for the Red Devils. And before you know it, you're in cap and gown. It's hard to believe it happens so fast, but it does. So as you consider all that lies before you, know that you can accomplish anything you set your mind to do. You can be anything you wish to be. I have every reason to believe that you will make the right choices. Enjoy your visit to this wonderful place. Thank you, and God bless you.
Well, perhaps you have guessed that speech and those words were written and assisted by our speaker, Mark Weinberg. And so when I heard, when Mark was watching this today, he said, the student said, hey, are you aware of this? And he said, well, I worked on that section of the speech. It's like, Mark, you perfectly captured Eureka College. Thank you so much. So before I call you on stage, I do have one little bit of business. I want to be sure to recognize our former trustees and our current trustees. If you would all just stand for a moment. On Founders Day, our trustees are here. Thank you so much. We have a very nice showing of trustees, and I appreciate it so much. They are here actually conducting the business of the college with trustee meetings today and tomorrow. So we so appreciate the work that you do for our college. Thank you. So I'm getting ready to call our speaker to the podium, but I want you to know a little bit about him. Mark Weinberg is a best-selling author, public speaker, political commentator, and speechwriter who has appeared on dozens of national television and radio programs across the country. His memoir, Movie Nights with the Reagans, chronicles his more than 10 years at President Reagan's side, including weekends at Camp David, where he watched hundreds of movies with the first couple. Mark spent more weekends at Camp David than any other White House staff member in history, and he is one of only a handful of people who was present at all 5 of Reagan's summits with Mikhail Gorbachev. Mark's commentaries on political issues have been published in a wide range of outlets, including the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, USA Today, the Huffington Post, the Washington Times, CNN.com, and that's only to name a few. We are so very honored to have you with us today, Mark. Did you write that? That was wonderful. Please come to the stage and make some remarks for us.
Yeah, I wrote that intro about myself. It's pretty good, right? So let me just, before I begin my prepared remarks here, let me just say with regard to the video, I probably shouldn't have given up the president when I said, yeah, I wrote part of that, because, you know, the myth is he wrote everything all himself. But let me just tell you a little story I told earlier today. The way things worked with speech writing in the Reagan White House, and especially post-presidential, was, you know, you had a system. You get a request for a speech, and you'd work on it, and you'd give them a draft, and come out, and so on. Well, there were two exceptions to that. When it was about Eureka, the rule was, better ask him. Because, you know, he's going to have some things he wants to say. So whether he was president, former president, whatever, whenever it was something for Eureka, there was the better ask him rule, which meant somebody said, hey, sir, before we do this, present your draft, is there anything you'd want to say? And then you'd inevitably get into the story about washing dishes in the girls' dormitory and all that stuff. But Eureka, and the other category was old Hollywood. If he would get requests for messages, letters, appearances, or things for old Hollywood, people who he had acted with way back when, before any staffer did anything routine, his secretary would go in and say, we've got this request from George Burns or something, did you want to do something? And 9 times out of 10, he'd say, let me ask Nancy what she wants to do. But Eureka and old Hollywood were the better ask him rule. So yes, I was involved in writing those words, but not before he got involved himself. Just want to clarify that. So, Shellie, thank you so much for that really brilliant introduction. And Madam President, and wouldn't it be nice if we could say that on a national basis? And I got to tell you, Ronald Reagan would be the first person in line to want to do that. Trustees, professors, administrators, staff, students, faculty, donors, my dear and valued friend John Morris, and friends of Ronald Reagan, thank you for honoring me by allowing me to be here tonight and for everything you do to keep alive the legacy of a man, a truly great man who I was blessed to know. Happy birthday, Mr. President. And a very special thank you to Shellie, who did so much to make my time here so memorable, a truly wonderful person. She is a great asset to Eureka. Shellie. Now, as some of you know, Ronald Reagan used to joke that his degree in economics from here was honorary, and I know how he felt. I probably shouldn't say this in the presence of the president of the university, but it took me 16 years to earn my undergraduate degree, and that was in journalism. I entered George Washington University as a freshman in 1975, and my diploma was signed in 1991. Now, I delayed my academic career for a political one, and that did not exactly thrill my parents, who of course wanted me to pursue a career in law or medicine. Remember how my last name ends. Even now, I am still traumatized by the fact that my parents recoiled in shock and horror when I told them that I was not finishing school on time because I was interested in politics, and Republican politics at that. That was almost too much for them. But one day I called them in 1980 and I said that I had been offered a paying job on the presidential campaign staff of Ronald Reagan, and they seemed less freaked out than I thought they'd originally been. And maybe they were just relieved about the fact that I was going to be on a payroll and wasn't going to come back and move into their basement. Or maybe it was because Reagan had been a movie star of their era and my mother thought he was handsome. Perhaps they agreed with some of what he had been saying, but I really didn't care. They were good with it, and thus I began the journey that brings me here today. And I must say that I have been a bit overwhelmed, not only by the warmth of your welcome, but by what I have seen today. And without being spooky, I feel Ronald Reagan's presence here, and I really like that. So enough about me, unless you want to hear more about me, which I'm... No? Okay. So what I thought I would do tonight, before I get to the part that I know will be, and I hope will be the highlight, and that would be the Q&A, is share a few thoughts about what made Ronald Reagan successful and how that might apply to us in everyday life. And then I'll tell you a little bit about the book after that. Okay, so what was the secret sauce of the Gipper? Well, with all due respect to a man I worked for more than a decade and admired and liked very much, who cares? I mean, really, what difference does it make all these years later how Reagan did what he did? And more importantly, why would it matter to anybody here unless one of you is planning to seek the presidency of the United States? I understand. Is anyone, by the way? John? No? Okay. Because... As some of you know, apparently anybody can be elected these days, so you kind of have to ask. But what I hope what I'm going to tell you about Reagan does indeed have some practical applications to what people do on a daily basis, regardless of where you are in life. As the noted motivational speaker Tony Robbins says, success leaves clues. And in the case of Ronald Reagan, the clues are clear. They are not breadcrumbs on a trail to greatness. They are loaves of bread. Now, Ronald Reagan has been blamed for and credited with many things, and I'm sure it will not surprise you that my comments tonight will be about what he deserves credit for. How did Reagan do it? Very simply, I call it the five P's. Planning, people, principles, perseverance, and partnering. Let me explain how those worked for Reagan. First is planning. For years, literally since his time here, Ronald Reagan studied the economy and thought about ways to stimulate economic growth. He came to Washington with a simple plan: get the government out of the way and cut taxes. Very simple, but that was his plan. He wanted people to keep more of the money they worked so hard for. Bringing back America and prosperity was his new priority. Now, maybe recalling what some of the professors, and I know there aren't any here who taught him, so I can say this, what his professors said, President Reagan would sometimes joke about learning at Eureka that two economists have three opinions. But he knew what needed to be done and how to do it. Now, some skeptics called his plan derisively, they did, Reaganomics. But Reagan was undeterred. He had a plan, and he knew that only if people had money in their pockets and incentives to invest and build businesses would jobs be created, inflation tamed, and interest rates reduced. So impressive was the Reagan recovery that at the G7 Economic Summit in 1983, when it was obvious that his plan was working, the West German Chancellor asked him to tell us about what he called the American miracle. Planning was also key to his success, especially in ending the Cold War. As with economics, for years Reagan had been concerned about what he considered the dangerous relationship between the United States and the then Soviet Union. And he was especially bothered by the threat that nuclear weapons posed to mankind. He was determined to reduce and perhaps even eliminate the threat that came to Washington. And he came to Washington with a plan to do that. Here's what his plan was: build up the U.S. military quickly and dramatically, make it plain to the Soviet Union that we had no intention of finishing second, and he had two goals there. One is he wanted us to have a strong military, and he also knew that if we spent a lot of money, they'd have to spend a lot of money, and that would ruin their economy. The second part of the plan was to speak openly and candidly about how bad Soviet behavior was. Remember when he called the Soviet Union an evil empire? That was intentional. He wanted Moscow to know that he meant business and he was no longer going to stay quiet in the face of their atrocities. The third part of his plan was a bit trickier. He believed two things. One was that the U.S. and Soviet Union did not mistrust each other because we were armed. We were armed because we mistrusted each other. And if we could somehow reduce the mistrust, we could then reduce the arsenal of deadly weapons. And second, he believed that it was better to talk to people instead of about them. So his plan was to get the Soviet counterpart in a room, talk to him man to man, and many of you in this room have met this Soviet counterpart that I'm about to reference, and convince him that the U.S. had no designs on the Soviet Union, there was no need for each country to have nuclear weapons pointing at each other's major cities. But plans do not implement themselves. People implement plans. And that brings us to the second P, people. Reagan did two critical things here. First, he hired men and women who shared his goals and had expertise in their fields. And secondly, he let them do their jobs. In terms of the economy, Reagan hired people like Jim Baker, Alan Greenspan, and others to implement the plan he had. In terms of U.S.-Soviet relations, he had men and women the likes of George Shultz, Colin Powell, Gene Kirkpatrick, and he let them do their jobs. He made it quite clear what his policies and objectives were, but he trusted them to get things done, and he did not micromanage. But contrary to popular belief, he was very engaged and well-informed on what his administration was doing. I have to tell you that when I was researching my remarks for tonight, I read through Reagan's private handwritten diary, the unabridged version, the one he kept every single night for 8 years. And I was struck by how much detail he went into on various policies. He knew a lot more than he sometimes let on. They haven't told me yet. That was sometimes a way to keep his adversaries off guard. He knew a lot. But he inherently understood that his role as president was literally to preside, which meant setting the goals and, like the government, getting out of the way of the people. He got out of the way of his team and let them do their job on a day-to-day basis. That brings me to the third P, principles. Ronald Reagan had beliefs and principles from which he did not deviate. He knew who he was, what he believed, and why he believed it. What he believed on Monday was what he believed on Friday, and he communicated those principles clearly. Reagan always remained true to his principles, and sometimes he could be a bit stubborn. Now, this is a little bit of a graphic story. I'll tell it anyhow. For example, during a tough moment in budget negotiations, he once told Tip O'Neill that he was, quote, willing to crap a pineapple but not a cactus. And Tip got the message. A budget deal was done shortly thereafter, and nobody was uncomfortable. That said, Reagan was not a rigid ideologue who was a 100% or nothing guy. He believed compromise was an essential part of governing. To Reagan, 75% was better than 0%. In terms of turning around the economy, his inviolable principles were clear from day one: reduce taxes and reduce government interference. And in terms of ending the Cold War, the principles were equally clear. The United States will never be vulnerable to being conquered by the Soviet Union or any other nation for that matter, and we will work tirelessly to rid the world of weapons that could literally wipe out civilization. Principles. And that inevitably leads to the fourth P, perseverance. Having principles and perseverance go hand in hand. Reagan never gave up. And that was never more clear or important than how he approached U.S.-Soviet relations. Remember that a key part of his plan was to establish a relationship with his counterpart in Moscow. As soon as he got in the White House, Reagan reached out to the Kremlin. But to his frustration, the Soviet leaders kept dying. There was Brezhnev and Andropov and Chernenko. Remember this? One after another, they died, and he used to say, well, they keep dying on me. But he persevered until the young and dynamic Mikhail Gorbachev took over. Finally, Reagan had someone with whom Margaret Thatcher said, we could do business. I was, as you've been told, at all five of Reagan's summits with Gorbachev and several post-White House meetings in California and in the then Soviet Union. And it was clear that both men respected and liked each other. I think they both also understood the value of a television camera. I don't think either one of them, that was lost on either one of them. They also understood their unique role in history and the opportunity they had been presented to make a real difference. And I remember Gorbachev would point to Reagan and said, this man never gives up. And here I have to tell you something I have not told many people at all. When Reagan was a former president and the Soviet Union was beginning to crumble and the Berlin Wall was on its way down, as he had called for, we went to Germany. And he was a former president this time, and he chipped at the wall. There are pictures of him at the Berlin Wall literally chipping it away. And I asked him shortly after he had done that, when we were back at the hotel, if he ever thought he would see that day. And he seemed a little surprised by my question, and I will never forget what he said. He said, well, of course I did. You know, with a tone of, well, of course I did. Communism and oppression never survive. Freedom always eventually triumphs. That's just human nature. But you have to persevere. And he did the same thing in turning around the economy. Even though he had a Republican Senate at first, Reagan had a Democratic House, and the sailing was not always smooth. But literally nothing would deter him. I remember vividly how shortly after he was nearly assassinated at the beginning of his term, he summoned, once he got home from the hospital, he summoned congressional leaders to the White House to twist their arms on his tax reduction proposals. He wore pajamas to that meeting because he was still recuperating up in the family quarters there. Now, there were those who understood the dramatic appeal of the president in pajamas, but nonetheless, he wore pajamas to that meeting, and because he wanted those members of Congress to know that he meant business, and he was not giving up, and he was not going to let that little incident stand in his way. It was a little bit of the old Hollywood and Reagan and flair for the dramatic, but nonetheless, it was him. He persevered. And he knew that hanging tough on the Soviets and hanging tough on the U.S. Congress was the only way to get what he wanted and what he thought the country needed, more importantly, and he did. Finally, then, we come to the fifth P, partnering. That, too, was a critical element in how Reagan turned around the economy and ended the Cold War. It didn't hurt that Ronald Reagan liked people. Maybe because he was comfortable in his own skin, he never seemed uncomfortable around people, whether they were his political allies or his political enemies. It didn't matter. He loved to tell a story, preferably a joke. I mean, he had at his heart an entertainer's personality. And even though some have described him as a bit of a loner or someone who needed only Nancy to be happy, my experience was is that he lit up most brightly when he was in a room and had a few people around him standing off in a corner there and was telling a joke. He enjoyed that, to making them laugh. In some ways, he was a pleaser, and that's what they do. He got pleasure in delighting his audiences, and that was because he was a people person. Now, what does that have to do with turning around an economy or ending a Cold War? It actually has a lot to do with it, because he knew that he couldn't accomplish either of those things by himself. And it seems appropriate that he was a people person. He wasn't an island, and he knew that anything great would be accomplished only when he worked together with people. Now, because he'd been a governor and understood and respected the role of the legislature, he formed relationships. Some were even true friendships with allies and foes in Congress when he got to Washington, because he knew that was where the rubber met the road. Think for a moment of the relationship that Ronald Reagan had with Tip O'Neill. Two stubborn old Irishmen with literally opposite views of the proper role of government. They came together to accomplish what was best for the people of this country. Not exactly what we have in Washington today. Ronald Reagan did not expect to accomplish things by himself, and he genuinely welcomed partnerships, even if they struck some as unlikely. And there was no more unlikely partnerships than Ronald Reagan and Mikhail Gorbachev or Ronald Reagan and Tip O'Neill. Ronald Reagan, if you were to ask him, would tell you that he did not turn around the economy and he did not end the Cold War. He would tell you, well, the people did. But the truth of the matter is, Reagan's role in both was indisputably pivotal. He studied and understood the economy and the Soviet Union. He knew what he wanted to accomplish and why. He had a plan. He hired the best people and let them do their jobs. He compromised when it made sense, but never ever on the fundamental principles that were so important to him. He never gave up. He believed that selling began when the customer said no. He persevered. And he partnered with men and women who could help him achieve his goals. Planning, people, principles, perseverance, and partnering. Far from magic, those five P's are the ones which I would argue have application everywhere, whether you are a student, professor, administrator, lawyer, parent, retiree, doctor, businesswoman, or anything else. That's how Reagan accomplished what he did, and those five pillars can help anyone, anywhere succeed in anything they choose to do. Now, that's the official Reagan, Please let me wrap up, as I said I would at the beginning, by sharing some personal memories of my time with him. Now, you may have been told that I recently wrote a book about my experience with the Reagans, and I have to tell you that writing a book was not anything anyone who knew me or I expected. It's not that I didn't cherish my time with the Reagans, but I mean, listen, I'm a little bit lazy, and frankly, I didn't think I had a story to tell. I mean, come on, there have been how many books about Reagan? I think every single one is downstairs, right, in the Shankman record. I mean, there have been really that many about that guy? I was struck by it yet again today. Book after book, many of them are excellent, were written about the present Mrs. Reagan, and I just didn't, it never occurred to me. But then as I saw these books, it occurred to me one little piece of the picture was missing. No one was writing about what I thought was a very important aspect of their lives together. How they were in private, primarily at Camp David, and the movies they watched, how those influenced him, and what we could learn from them. Nobody was writing that story. So my wife urged me to share that part of the Reagan legacy, and she very nicely pointed out, well, she said, honey, it's a story only you can tell. I said, that's right. And then she said, and by the way, it's the only story you can tell. So turns out she was right. I was not a policy person, but I did have a unique vantage point over those 10 years and a unique relationship with the Reagans, and so I wrote the book. And I set out to share with everyone what the Reagans were like in private, at their most relaxed, at Camp David, in a modest home with a very few aides, no press, no ceremony, just them, as they did what they enjoyed most, watching movies in their living room there. Not surprising when you consider that they were both former movie stars and proud veterans of Hollywood. It was, after all, there that they met, began their life together, and learned things that would help them be, in my humble opinion, the most successful and beloved first couple in modern history. Now, to his credit, Ronald Reagan never shied away from having been an actor. He was proud of that, just as he was proud of Eureka. He was proud of who he was. Some of us stuffed shirts on the staff were not convinced, but he respected the movie business and even went so far as to say he did not see how you could be president and succeed without having been an actor. That really didn't make the staff very happy to hear, but he would say it. And I need not tell you how the press would use that against him from time to time. So one day I asked him, so what do you mean when you say that you don't think you could have succeeded as president without having been an actor? And he very articulately explained the striking similarities that I had never really thought of. Being on a stage and needing to communicate with millions of people at once who are in an audience. Appreciating the impact of a well-delivered line or a gesture. Living in the glare of constant scrutiny and publicity and developing a tough skin, looking the part, and respecting the technical needs of the people whose job it was to arrange lighting and sound and photography. As my kids would say, he totally got it, and he was right. And Ronald Reagan was the first modern-day presidency to understand that the presidency is a performance job and that television is essential to communicating with the people. He got it. So I set out in the book to take readers behind the scenes at Camp David, literally into their living room, as they watched and for the most part enjoyed so many iconic movies of the 80s. Top Gun, which was a special favorite of theirs, by the way. Back to the Future, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, On Golden Pond, Ghostbusters, Rocky, Oh God, Book Two, the students here don't remember any of them, War Games, among many others, and some of what the Reagans called golden oldies, one of which they acted in together. That was Hellcats of the Navy, but we did see that. We saw Bonzo, and we saw the Canute Rodney story. And I wanted to share what they thought about the movies, how they may have impacted things, and how they related to what was going on in the country and in the Reagan lives at that time. And I share some anecdotes from my perspective, that of a not-so-worldly 20-something in a remarkable job, and how this truly wonderful couple was so warm welcoming, and exemplary. Perhaps the most gratifying aspect of writing Movie Nights with the Reagans came toward the end. Mrs. Reagan was kind enough to grant me an interview, and it was the last one she gave before she died for this book at her home in Los Angeles. You can read the introduction for details if you want, but it was clear to me that she was excited about what I was doing and believed it was a story worth telling. She shared memories of their years in Hollywood, commented about how the movie business prepared them for the White House, and talked about how special the movie nights at Camp David were to her and her husband, and even, under some gentle pressure, she told me what her favorite movie was. I wish I had finished that book in time to deliver one to her, but things did not work out that way, but that's okay, because the legacy of Nancy and Ronald Reagan lives on, and no more robustly than here at Eureka. And were he here, I suspect President Reagan would be very happy about my making a speech like this. He loved this place. He never stopped talking about Eureka. Eureka meant something to him, something special that he carried in his heart. And no matter where he went or what he did, Eureka was part of who he was. And he was unfailingly proud to have studied here. And you know, I gotta tell you, I never really got that. Until today. Now I do. And I hope you won't think that I am out of line for saying, thank God for Eureka, thank God for Ronald Reagan, and thank God for all of you who do so much to honor him and keep alive his spirit and his extraordinary legacy. Thank you.
Thank you, technology. We have a little moment. So thank you so much, Mark. We have just a few minutes for a couple of questions from the audience, and I believe we have one of our Reagan fellows who has a microphone in the audience. So you better be quick, because there's only time for two or three questions. So anyone have a question for Mark? Thank you. Wait, where's the microphone? There we go. It's right there.
How you doing? That was wonderful.
Thank you.
This is a real tricky question. Understanding Reagan on a personal level, what do you think his views would be about the current administration?
Well, I'm sorry, did you ask about the weather? Because, you know, when I flew in last night, it was snowing and so forth. Okay, it's a perfectly fair question, and I said long before I got here that I will answer anything about anything to do with the Reagans. Here's what I think. I think he would be appalled by the tone and the lack of civility in Washington on both sides of the aisle. I think it would bother the hell out of him that you have to turn off the television for fear that I have to turn off the television for fear that my teenage son will hear what politicians in Washington say. I think he would be very disappointed by the personal nature, the meanness of spirit, the visceral approach that people in both parties take, the self-crediting, the self-preservation, the lack of national interest. I think that would bother him immensely on both sides. However, that is a cowardly answer. The more honest answer is taking the policies out of the mix, the robust economy and the revised trade agreements and things which people can argue are successes. Ronald Reagan believed that the presidency was an office that belonged to the people, that occupying it temporarily was a sacred trust, and that one should conduct themselves in a way of which all people could be proud, and that you represented this country, and that you were president of all the people. And I think he would be bothered, frankly, by the conduct. Now, you may say, well, the others do it on the other side, and she ripped up the speech, and, you know, there's enough plague on both of their houses, and there's enough plague to go around, and the media this, and the Democrats that, and all that, and there's a great deal of validity to that. But Reagan was a president, and when he walked into that Oval Office, he had a reverence for that office and that job and that position that was a joy to behold, and I think he would be deeply disturbed by the tone, and he believed that at the end of the day, the president's the top fella, that's the phrase he would use, and he should set the tone. I may be wrong, it's impossible to know, but knowing him as I did, that this man was nothing if not a gentleman. And I think he would be bothered by the tone.
Thank you. Another question?
So now that we've talked about politics, let's talk about religion. Reagan seemed, when he wrote and he talked, to use the language of faith very easily. It seemed very natural to him. What was your experience working with him on speeches where he wove religious language throughout? Was it as natural as it looked like? And just how did he talk about the language of faith or talk about his own faith when the cameras were on?
Well, there's several things I can tell you about that. He did not talk about his faith very much. And the reason for that was, not just because I come from a Jewish background, but even in the presence of any group, because he did not want people to feel uncomfortable. He did not want anybody to feel excluded. He did not want anybody to be diminished or feel that their belief was inferior or to his and that his way was the only way. He believed deeply in separation of church and state. However, he was a man of faith, and I'll tell you how I know that. One is, shortly after he was shot, a cardinal of the Catholic Church, obviously, called on him at the White House, and Reagan was Presbyterian, he said to that cardinal, I believe all the time that I have left belongs to God, that the Lord spared me for a reason, and he believed that. Now, he was criticized, as you know, for not going to church. And the reason he didn't go to church as President of the United States is because the Secret Service asked him not to. They told him that if you go, you will make all those people in the church a target, and we're going to have to set up metal detectors and things of that kind. He said, well, I certainly don't want that. That's not fair to them. I don't want to be disruptive. So he didn't go, and it bothered him. Now, from time to time, they would have a private preacher come to the White House at Christmas and do things with the family, but it bothered him to not be able to go to church. And he didn't, other than on like Easter or other occasions where we could go very spur of the moment and you wouldn't have to set up the massive security apparatus. But as soon as he got back to California, after the 8 years as president, the issue of going back to church on every Sunday, he went to Bel Air Presbyterian Church. He and Nancy were members of that for years. And they asked him, well, are you going to go back to church? And he said, well, of course we're going. We're going Sunday. And from the day he got back on a Thursday or Friday. 3 days later, they resumed their years-long pattern of going to church every single Sunday. And that's just who he was. He realized as president that separation of church and state, and you're president of all the people, so you got to be careful about your language. And he also was a little uncomfortable with those who would suggest that there was a superiority one way or the other, that he was inclusive. But I will tell you one other story about him and his faith. After 10 or so years of working for him, I went into him one day, and he was a former president at the time. We were in the office in Los Angeles, and I told him that I thought it was time for me to get back to other things, to finally finish my 16-year plan for my undergraduate diploma and do some other things and move on. I'd been with him 8 in the White House, 2 in California. It just seemed like a logical time. And he said, well, you know, I was wondering when you were going to do that. I would never have asked because you can stay here as long as you want. You're part of the family. But I was wondering when a young man would want to go on and do something else. He said, you know, after all, I'm not going to be here forever. And I knew exactly what he meant. I knew exactly what he meant. And I said, oh, I know know that, Mr. President. I mean, I presume eventually that one day you'll move your office to the library and maybe even, you know, live at the ranch. And he said, no, Mark, I mean here. And I said, really? I said, I think I must have turned green. I said, oh, sir, please don't say that. And he said, no, with the most easygoing matter of fact, he said, no, I'm not afraid of that. In fact, I'm looking forward to it. And I said, oh, please don't ever tell anybody that. I walked out of the room. And he believed deeply and unshakably that there is a heaven and that it is a place where there's no pain and no suffering and people will be reunited and that he would be there. He absolutely believed in something better on the other side. And he carried that with him to his last living breath.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you very much for those excellent questions. I think we've covered a lot of ground in two questions. I'm going to finish with one final question, Mark. I'm sorry.
Really?
We're on a schedule. People have a lot of work to do tomorrow, so
I'll stick around.
For the college, yes. Yeah. So Mark will be around signing books when we finish. So you certainly are welcome to ask him questions at the end of the evening. My final question is, how did Ronald Reagan evolve and change? Did you witness any change when he was in the White House?
You know, it's a funny thing. I've thought about this, and one of the things that people would say about Ronald Reagan was, what you saw was what you got, he was who he was, the office didn't go to his head, the fame didn't go to his head, fortune didn't go to his head, that he was the same fellow who walked into the White House on January 20th, 1981, as he was when he walked out on January 20th, 1989, that he was who he was. But, and then you have that issue that everybody grows and changes. Experiences change people. Life changes people. You can't have a job like that for 8 years and not be changed. And, you know, we used to take great pride in saying, you know, Ronnie is who he is. They broke the mold when they made him, and he's the original and all that. But the truth of the matter is, I think there were two ways in which he changed, or in which he was at least impacted or evolved. One is on the religion thing. I think after he was shot and said that to the cardinal, and I don't remember which cardinal, I want to say Spellman, but I could easily be wrong. But whenever he said that, I think he was more, his faith was heightened. He was always faithful, but I think that impacted him and it made him more faithful. The other issue I saw his position evolve on was on guns. And the reason for that is because he was shot, but more importantly, because Jim Brady was shot. And Reagan, as you know, was a Westerner. Even though he's from here, he still became a Westerner, at least in many respects. And he believed in the Second Amendment for people to protect themselves and for sport and hunting. He was not one of those who believed that people should own bazookas or military assault rifles at any point. He believed that was its purpose, and that should be protected at all costs in the Constitution. And after Jim Brady got shot, and Reagan realized that that bullet was meant for him, you could see, and the NRA did what it did and positioned itself as it positioned itself over time, they lost him. And that was a big loss. He had been a card-carrying member of the NRA for years and years and years, and he became very disappointed in what he called their shrill rhetoric. And Sarah and Jim Brady's experience had a big influence on him, which is why he came out for the Brady Bill, as you may know. He endorsed it over the opposition of President George H.W. Bush and most of the people in the Republican Party. And that was a change, because I do not think, had he not experienced what happened to Jim and Sarah, and what happened to himself, but really more what that did to Jim and how the NRA behaved, he would have done that. So that is an area in which I think the presidency and what happened during the presidency impacted him and brought him to a different point than where he was when he got there.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you. We chatted just briefly this morning about that, and I thought it was very worthwhile to bring up this evening. And so in closing, I'd like to say that I believe that Ronald Reagan learned through his liberal arts education how to keep his mind open, how to accept different opinions, and I am very proud of that with our college.
Yes.
So well, thank you so much.
Oh, you're
I would like to invite Dr. Wright forward. We have a little gift for you this evening. Yes, I have one right here. Well, actually, no, you for him.
Thank you,
yes.
Do you want to?
Oh, you can have mine. I haven't eaten mine. There you are. Yes.
So, Mark, you did a fantastic job. Please give Mark another round of applause. It was absolutely amazing. We so appreciate you being here. I knew you were all in for a treat. They're standing for you. Token of appreciation. However, it comes with a very, very strong requirement that you wear it and you take a picture the first time you do.
Okay.
So have one of your kids, or you can do a selfie.
I can.
And then every time you visit, because we expect you to visit often.
I would like to.
You are now part of the Eureka College family.
Oh,
we would like for
you
to wear this tie, of which Will Ball over there is modeling for you.
Thank you very much.
So you can see exactly.
Oh, very nice. Very nice.
That's right, he's modeling it. And I know it will look very, very wonderful on you.
Oh, you're
so
very
thank
nice.
You so very
thank
much.
You.
We appreciate
thank
you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Mark. Every Eureka College event ends with a very special song. So I would like to call up Elsie Croasdale and Cody Wirth to lead us in the alma mater.
Yes, come on over.
By our speaker this evening, and it was at George Washington University, and they arranged this special tribute to Reagan, so we're very pleased to be able to share that with you tonight. Thank you all so very much for celebrating with us this evening. We truly appreciate it. Please visit with Mark over at the book signing table. I know he would love to take a few more questions on one-on-one. And thank you again for coming.